Views expressed on the following broadcast do not necessarily reflect those of KHLT, Take 12 Radio, or our affiliates. The opinions on this show should not be considered as medical, psychological, or professional advice and are those of the host, co-host, and guest. Take 12 Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting are not affiliated with any particular 12-step fellowship.
Welcome to Entitled to Overcome, Exploring Solutions for Life Today, a presentation of Take 12 Recovery Radio. And now, here are your co-hosts, Dave Fleming and the Monty Man.
Sing it, Dave!
Overcome.
That's Vid. Singing,
overcome.
Singing one word. Well, welcome to Entitled to Overcome, Solutions for Life. When, Dave?
Today.
Today, yay, yay. It's good to have you with us. As many of you know, our scheduling has kind of changed up a bit. So the first Monday of the month, we have the Victory Report with Arizona Teen Challenge, the men and women sharing their experience, strength, and hope, and how they have overcome life-controlling issues through the power of God. On the second Monday of the month, we have the Great Reality with Tony, Denver, Marv, and myself. Yes, and that's always a hoot. Hoot, hoot. And then the third Monday of the month is the vid. Mr. Dave Fleming, certified alcohol and drug counselor level 2.
Just certified.
And very certifiable. As he sits directly across from me in the studio.
This is the third Friday or Monday already?
This is the third Monday.
Wow.
Yeah, can you believe that?
Yeah, it's only the 15th.
2 weeks ago, I turned 63. Just 2 weeks ago, I was a young man. Now I'm...
You're just old.
I just...
Old as dirt.
Crested over the top of the, the top of the hill.
I had a birthday last week.
Did you really?
Yeah.
You had a birthday last week. Did I send you happy birthday on Facebook?
My recovery birthday.
Oh, that's right. You did have that. And I did say happy birthday.
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm sorry I haven't got a chance to get on there and thank everybody. Especially you. I mean, you put that nice little
cartoon.
Cartoony thing on there. And
right.
I was very touched.
Yeah.
It meant a lot to me.
You are touched. That's why you're certifiable.
Yeah, I thought that's why we came here, right? Is this a counseling session?
This is. So, how did you feel about your horse when growing up?
Well, I when he knocked me off, and I still have a scar on my forehead.
Yeah,
but I had to. Get back on the horse, you know?
So you didn't have a horse resentment? Or a cow resentment?
I don't think so. But
oh, my
memory is kind of spotty. Did you hear something?
No. What? I hear a squeak. Oh, okay.
I was just wondering, you know, my past came to visit me for some reason.
Nope. No, I just wonder how you felt about your horse. I didn't even know if you had a horse. I thought that was probably less personal than how'd you feel about the way your mother raised you?
Well, how much time do you got? I feel okay now.
Oh, my goodness. So welcome, everybody. I want to say a special thank you to one of our major, major sponsors, Patrick LeBeau. Patrick.
Hey, Patrick.
Sent us a couple times a year. He sends us a pretty hefty donation, and between him and particularly one other guy, and then a small handful of folks that do a monthly pledge kind of thing, we're able to keep doing this. And so, Patrick, thank you so very much. At some point, he's going to be up here, traveling this way, and we'll make sure that he gets on one of our shows. So, Patrick, thank you so much. If you'd like to donate to keep Take 12 Recovery Radio on the air, you simply go to take12radio.com and scroll down to the bottom of the page and click on the donate button. And it'll take you to a page. It tells you how to write a check, how to do a money order, how to do credit card, all that kind of stuff. if that's something you feel strongly about. There, got that out of the way.
That'd be great. I think I'm gonna donate too, because you know, someday soon I'd like to be able to get our video feed up and running.
And then you would be the vid, the video. Oh,
I like what you did there.
Yeah, you like that? Well, this episode of
do you know why they call me vid?
Yeah, because it's the last part of day.
Vid.
Yeah, that one. Yeah. On this episode of Entitled to Overcome, Solutions for Life Today with Mr. Dave Vid Fleming, we're going to be talking about complacency.
Uh-oh.
So I have a question, Dave, for everybody out there before we get to our icebreaker.
Mm-hmm.
Have you become, maybe unaware of it even, complacent in your recovery to where...
Well, if I'm unaware, how can I answer the question yes or no?
Well, maybe me asking that will shake something loose. A marble or two. Have you just gotten
into... I don't think there's anything left up in there to shake around.
Not much. But sometimes we can get into a pattern in our recovery process. And I'm speaking to those people that are actually in recovery now. But we can be complacent in life. I mean, in any aspect of life, we really can. But we can get into a pattern of, okay, I go to my weekly meeting or maybe a couple times a week. I drink coffee and I talk about my day. And we can get comfortable. And there, boy, there's nothing wrong with that. If you've been going to meetings and you still are, don't stop. But sometimes, or we can end up working with people and never fellowshipping in the meetings and never going back. Or we can be doing none of that because we think we got it. And so we're not accountable to anybody, a spiritual advisor, mentor, anybody.
I guess the question should be what quantifies complacency?
Sure.
Or not, or complacent.
Being complacent.
In recovery.
So we're going to be talking about that here in just a couple of seconds. Right, Dave?
That's right, Monty.
All right, Dave. But first, I think it's almost time.
What was that?
Ah, boy. Here we go.
Is it a bomb?
It's time for Dave and Monty's
Might as well be.
Icebreaker.
Yes. Bank of...
Whoa, wait. It should be like this, Monty.
Do that again.
This is Halloween
this month. Wow.
Wow, that was loud.
That
was really loud.
What?
I can't hear you.
I can't
Dave.
Hear anything now. Hello?
Oh, my goodness. Bank of America reported Alberto, and I don't have the heart to say his last name, so we'll just call him Alberto, to the Arizona authorities in 2016. They suspected Lopez. I just said his last name.
What the?
Wow. I just remembered the bus. Oh, boy. I don't know. That deserves this. all right. Well, Alberto Lopez, you did the crime, so here we go. They suspected Alberto, then an employee of a local branch. They suspected he had stolen $5,000 from the bank over the course of 3 months. Mr. Lopez promptly quit his job and moved to Phoenix because he was thinking that maybe they caught on. Well, in early this year, 2018, Mr. Lopez applied for a job as a dispatcher for the Cottonwood Police Department, despite the fact that he was still a fugitive. The police thought the easiest way to catch Mr. Lopez was to schedule an interview. When he arrived at the station, he was promptly arrested. So you steal from a bank, you abscond with the money, and then you go apply for a position with a law enforcement agency. That's real swift.
You can see me on Radio Land. I'm shaking my head in dismay and disbelief.
Savadiri is his middle name, so I might as well just throw his whole name under the bus, Alberto Salvadori Lopez. Yeah, so Mr. Lopez, not too smart. Either one of those things there. Well, here's number two. We only have two today, Dave. In Leicester, Massachusetts, a shoplifter tried to block a security camera at a local retailer. Guess what he tried to use, Dave? Take a giant guess.
I don't know.
You don't know. Of course you don't know. Well, I'm going to tell you.
Take a wild guess. But
okay.
His underwear?
No. That may have been smarter. I'm not sure, though. It may not have been. He used Play-Doh. Okay. Well, the thief then fled the scene, leaving the Play-Doh behind.
With his fingerprints.
That's right. He did leave his fingerprints in the clay, which police used to identify him. The Leicester Police Department was apparently very amused by the incident and posted the story on their Facebook page.
The Play-Doh Bandit.
Whatever happened to creative lawbreaking, Dave? I guess it went out the window when you and I got sober.
I think so. I was just thinking the same thing.
Oh, my goodness. All right, so that does it for our little icebreaker there for this episode. Okie dokie. So we'll be back with the topic complacency right after this. Don't go away.
Lifeline Connections, providing a safe, confidential, and comfortable place for hope, help, and healing in the Pacific Northwest.
When I started receiving services at Lifeline Connections just over 6 years ago, I was so broken. I was homeless, I had a mental illness, and a substance use disorder. By being able to treat my mental illness first, I was able to gain the tools that I needed to overcome my mental illness and to treat my addiction. Lifeline Connections has given me the hope and healing that I needed to get my life back in order. Today, I am proud to say that I'm a success.
To speak with an addiction specialist, call 360-397-8246 or visit lifelineconnections.org.
Welcome back to Entitled to Overcome, Solutions for Life Today. The topic on this episode is complacency.
And it's kind of what happened to us, I guess.
Yeah,
a little bit, maybe. Does that fall into the category?
I don't know. Maybe busyness. Maybe complizziness.
Sounds like an excuse.
Complizziness. We got complizzy. Merriam-Webster's definition of complacency is very interesting. There's two here. One is self-satisfaction, especially when accompanied by unawareness of actual dangers or deficiencies.
Danger, Will Robinson, danger.
Did you see that Netflix thing on Lost in Space?
Oh, the new series?
The new one? Yeah.
I watched the old series yesterday. I was watching some of the old episodes.
What a hoot that old series. Dr. Smith, he's my man. That guy is just creepy. Number two, that was a rabbit trail. We're back now.
Squirrel.
Number two, definition of complacency, an instance of usually unaware or uninformed self-satisfaction. So it's kind of the same thing.
Okay.
But I just thought that was an interesting, because I'm thinking the thing
unaware
that popped
unaware of self-satisfaction.
Unaware or uninformed self-satisfaction. In other words, what came to my mind is when I got so complacent at some point in my recovery program very early on when I thought, I got this, right? And I felt self-satisfied, so self-satisfied and competent that I had this thing, that I became unaware of some of the dangers that were surrounding me. I didn't see the red flags of relapse. They just weren't something I was noticing because I was so stuck on, I got this. I don't need your help. I've read the steps on the wall. Therefore, I've done them. I'm fine.
I guess that being the other side of that, well, unaware or uninformed, would be, let's say you get busy, right?
Yeah.
And it's like, well, I'm going to be late for this meeting. I guess I'll just skip it. And then go about your business, right?
Right.
And then that, well, I was okay. So, you know, maybe the next day, the same thing happens.
It'll be easier.
Or the next week.
Right.
Same thing happens. You know, oh, they want me to stay overtime at work. You know, I'm not going to make my meeting today. I've been okay. I guess I'm okay.
I was okay for two weeks without going to a meeting.
Yeah, I'm okay.
And I'll go back. I'll go back. I just, right now, I'm busy. Yeah, you're right. And that probably is
sneaky one.
That, yeah, I was going to say, that's probably harder to spot than the kind of the obvious, I got this. When I was in treatment, one of the things we do, of course, is relapse signs and recovery signs, right? So on my list of relapse signs at the very top, which my counselor helped me to realize, was getting busy doing good things. Mm-hmm. So I would become overly busy doing stuff that was good. Normally, I mean, each individual project or job was good, but I was doing so much of it that my program ended up being at the bottom of the pile. And I was using my work as my program. And I was saying to myself, as long as I stay busy, all will be well. And it didn't turn out well because I burned out.
It's interesting. We watched a video this morning. If I can remember what it was called. No, I wrote it down on my other piece of paper. I don't have it. It's something to the effect of how your thoughts can, you know, how to change your thoughts to keep them from controlling you.
Hmm.
So when you're talking, I was just thinking about this. It's like one of the questions to ask yourself is like, where will these thoughts lead me? Right. So if I'm thinking about, you know, being complacent, or if I'm okay, like the example I gave me,
yeah.
I'm okay. I've been okay for a couple of weeks. I've been good. So if I process that through the, you know, something like that, you know, where will those thoughts lead me? It was like, who was it? I'll have to give a shout out here. Charles Stanley.
Oh yeah.
So I just went into YouTube and typed in control, and it if you want to go watch this, it's about 53 minutes. It was an awesome. I got like a whole page of notes on his sermon. So if you're interested, it is very good.
Charles Stanley, control.
Charles Stanley.
Hmm. Andy, yeah. Stanley's dad.
I don't know.
Andy Stanley's the one that made that statement. In light of my past experiences, my current circumstances, and my future hopes and dreams, what's the wise thing to do? Now, what's fair? Now, what's right? Certainly not what's legal or art. What's wise? Andy Stanley. It's on my desk.
On whose perspective?
It's on my desk.
Per whose perspective?
That would be from a biblical perspective.
Okay.
Yeah. So,
girl.
So, complacency can come really without us even realizing it, right?
Yeah, I think that's the whole point.
That's the whole point. So we need to be ultra aware of the possibility of falling into that. And I think anybody can fall into complacency. It doesn't matter what you're doing in life, whether it's your job, your relationship with your spouse, or your recovery.
I think one of the things that keeps me from going down that avenue,
mm-hmm.
is reading a meditation. So whether it's, you know, Just for Today, or it's, you know,
right.
The Man Within, or whatever, Touchstones, any, you know, if whatever I'm reading will usually keep me on track, or remind me, hey, you're being complacent today.
You try to do that every day?
I try to do that every day, yeah.
Yeah.
Sometimes I don't do it in the same time every day. Sometimes I forget.
Right.
But the way my life is now, I changed what I do. So the movies that I watch feed me healthy things into my spirit. To be honest, not all of them are probably healthy, but music and other programs I listen to on the radio, you know. Mm-hmm. I usually, or if when I'm driving, I'll do like the Daily Ideal Bible is an app that I use that I really like. It goes through a different version of the Bible every, week or two. They just do a rotation. So it's like a 1-year Bible reading.
Right.
It's kind of cool. Anyway, so with all those things, I usually will get, if I get off track, I'll have a reminder somewhere along the way.
Right.
To get me back on track. Now, you know, I work in the field, so I tend to surround myself with, you know, reminders.
Constant
reminders. But sometimes I can get complacent and not always, work on my own program.
Right.
That's why I have to stay diligent and process like how my day's going, what I'm doing, my interactions with other, you know, the old step 10 inventory. I don't always write it out, but I do mental notes.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll write stuff down, or I'll do, if something like catches my mental note, I'll do some research or I'll do a study or something on it.
Yeah. You know, there was a point in my recovery where some things were going sideways and I couldn't really pinpoint it. And my attitude was getting kind of weird. The way I was carrying myself, things like that. And my sponsor asked me, he said, I want to sit down with you. I want to ask you a question. I said, go ahead, brother. He said, what were you doing before this happened that you're not doing now? You know, and it really didn't take a whole lot of thought. There were some things that I wasn't doing. I wasn't reading, because I like to read the 24-hour a day book, the little black book.
Yep.
I would read that religiously every single morning. I had stopped doing that. My prayer life, in fact, I got to say, my prayer life is what started to suffer first. I started getting busy. And so my prayer life consisted of driving to work, going, God, protect me while I'm driving. Give me traveling mercies from point A to point B. Amen. And that, or grace over dinner. And that's pretty much what my prayer life was. And so I had stopped doing that on a regular basis. I had stopped reading my literature that was helping me so much. And as I looked at it, I'd actually stopped going to as many meetings because I'd gotten busy. I hadn't been calling my sponsor nearly as much, you know. And this was pretty early. This was the first 3 years of my sobriety. And so I started naming these things off. You go, okay, so what kind of reset button are we setting here? Are we going to start doing that again? What are we going to do? And that was the answer. I needed to hit the reset button and go back to when things were going well and do those things. And I think a lot of times we know what to do, but like you said, the busyness of life gets in the way and it'll sneak in. And even the enemy of our soul, will give an applause to it. Go, he's getting too busy. In fact, if I can't get him to sin, I'll get him to get too busy. And that's exactly what had been happening with me. And I know people today. I know people that are listening to this show because I got a few emails that said, uh-oh, you're meddling now. This is me. Complacency is me. And so they're listening today. Take heed. What were you doing before?
Right.
That you're not doing now? That might be a good question to ask.
Well, you know, and I've had some, I you know, I always talk about God working in all things. Sometimes we see it. Sometimes it's subtle.
Yeah.
One of the things that gets us distracted oftentimes is, you know, one of our favorite things is being on Facebook, right? Because one, we're trying to get out there and we're trying to, you know, spread the good news. We're trying, you know, trying to share the message from Take 12 Radio. But also, we get caught up in all the other nonsense that's going on in life. Well, the thing that I like about one of the things I like about Facebook is it will pop up, you know, things from the past.
Oh, yeah, 2 years ago.
And then it'll, at the bottom, if you look, in small little prints, it'll say, see more memories.
Mm.
And so you click on there, and so I like, whenever that pops up, I like going in there and seeing what else I was doing
right,
you know, last year, 2 years ago, you know, 5 years ago, whatever. And, you know, I can sit there and I can see where I was at certain different points in my life. What was I posting? What was I, you know, what was I thinking about? What was I sharing with people? And that is sometimes a good reminder of I need to get back on track, or, you know,
maybe I need to call so-and-so.
I'm doing the right thing, or,
yeah.
Oh yeah, you know, I did get a, I don't know if I shared this with you, but you know, there's a person in my, that was in my life, that I went to high school with, that they've come into my mind now and again, and, you know, going to reunions and things like that. People always ask, well, like, you know, have you seen so-and-so? And, you know, do you know? So this person has been, you know, I've always kind of wondered what happened to this person. Got a line here and there, tried to reach out, got nothing. Well, Friday, or no, it must have been Thursday. Yeah, Thursday. They typed a response into one of my comments that I had on Facebook, and I was just like, whoa.
Where'd that come from?
So I sent them a private message, and it turns out they're in recovery now. They've got a few months and under their belt. And they're working on the program. I thought this is great. I mean, what a blessing for my, you know, my spiritual birthday,
right?
I get, you know, reconnected with, you know, this person, and
which, by the way, you just celebrated how many years?
14
years.
Yeah.
Ooh, cowbell.
Yeah, I mean, I always, you know, I try not to always think about that, but. Because it still blows me away. I can't even, you know,
I can't
believe I got 1 year. But it, you know, because I always try to filter it through, you know, I have, you know, 14 years of one day at a time, because I try to process everything through today.
The 24-hour
staying thing. Present in today, you know, not getting too far into, you know, tomorrow or next week or what happened 10 years ago.
Right. Morbid reflection.
Yeah, it. Well, some of it wasn't so morbid. Some of it was pretty good.
Some of it was fun.
You know, so it was just a blessing to be able to hear that this person is on track and they're doing well. So it was quite blessed.
So you talked about reading like morning devotions or just for today, or mm-hmm. I mean, we have our recovery fellowships. Have tons of literature that's really good, really wonderful stuff, and we really ought to take if folks, if you're in a 12-step fellowship or a recovery fellowship of some kind, and they've got literature available for you, you really shouldn't cheat yourself. You should get a hold of some of that stuff. Some of it is just really, really useful. And you pulled something out of the Just for Today book, which is. Conference approved Narcotics Anonymous literature. True. There it is. He reaches over.
I don't get myself involved with that whole conference approved.
Well, I'm just saying.
If it has a recovery message, it's okay.
I'm just saying for the NA Nazis out there, so they won't write me hate letters.
I don't really hear about that in NA as much as I hear about it in AA. Is that conference approved literature?
Yeah, that's been my experience too.
Go sit down.
Yeah, go sit down, just listen. All right, go ahead, give it to us there, buddy.
So this, the title of this is Up or Down. So this is our road to spiritual growth. We change every day. This growth is not the result of wishing, but of action and prayer. Basic text, page 37. Spiritual condition is never static. If it's not growing, it's decaying. If we stand still, our spiritual progress will lose its upward momentum. Gradually, our growth will slow, then halt, then reverse itself. Yeah, I've had that happen.
Mm-hmm.
Our tolerance will wear thin. Mm-hmm. Our willingness to serve others will wane. Our minds will narrow and close. Before long, we'll be right back where we started, in conflict with everyone and everything around us, unable to bear even ourselves. Well, you were a witness to, I was kind of going through that, a little bit of that a few months ago.
Sure.
I was just, everything was irritating me.
Yeah.
Our only option is to actively participate in our program of spiritual growth. We pray, seek knowledge greater than ourselves, from a power greater than ourselves. We open our minds and keep them open, become teachable and taking advantage of what others have to share with us. We demonstrate our willingness to try new ideas and new ways of doing things, experiencing life in a whole new way. Our spiritual progress picks up speed and momentum, driven by the higher power we are coming to understand better each day. Up or down, it's one or the other, with very little in between. Where spiritual growth is concerned, recovery is not fueled by wishing and dreaming, we've discovered, but by prayer and action. Just for today, the only constant in spiritual condition is change. I cannot rely on yesterday's program today. I'll seek new spiritual growth through prayer and action.
So complacency is kind of like walking up a down escalator. You're very busy moving, but you're not going anywhere.
Right. Well, I think, you know, our recovery is based on our daily spiritual condition, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So if we're not working on that,
yeah,
which includes, for me anyway,
mm-hmm.
It's reading and doing service work and meetings and whatever else is.
Whatever's in your toolkit.
Going out and helping someone else, you know. It doesn't even have to be someone in recovery. Just
right.
Going out and helping someone else, that's part of that. Trying to improve myself every day, that's part of that spiritual condition. So if I'm not doing those things, then I'm being complacent.
You know, it's interesting because I was asked this, I will ask this of people that fall into the same category I once was in. I once got to the place in my life, in my personal faith, where I wasn't going to church anymore. So I was not fellowshipping with the people that believed the way I did spiritually. I had separated myself because I'd gotten too busy. And I was making statements, Dave, like, well, I can do this at home. I mean, I could, if I want to hear a good message, I can turn on the TV and watch somebody like Charles Stanley, for instance. Or, you know, I can pray with my spouse at home. I can read literature at home. I can do all these things at home. Why am I getting in my car, driving all the way across town when I really don't have time? And spending time with people when I can do all this at home. And what was asked of me was, but do you?
Well, yeah, and what are you doing?
Well, the fact is, I wasn't doing it at home. You know, are you watching the thing? Are you praying with your wife? Are you doing all these things you say you can do at home, and you don't have to be? But are you doing those? And the answer was no, I wasn't.
Well, regardless, we're social beings.
Yes.
So we have to interact with other people.
We do. That's how.
And
we're built.
Nothing so ensures our recovery but intensive work with others.
Right. That's right.
So, I mean, the instruction manual says we have to work with others.
Yeah.
That means not alone at home.
So, if you're saying, well, I don't need to go to meetings anymore. I've been sober for 15, 20 years. And I can read stuff out of the big book or the NA basic text or my Bible at home. I could call people up and talk to them and fellowship with them from my house. I can just say, but are you? Are you just saying,
well,
that's what you can
think
do?
About it? What you said, yeah. I don't need to.
I don't need to. So why?
Okay,
would you?
I don't need to either. I have to. I get to.
Yeah.
Because if I don't do it, then I stand a very great chance of falling back into where I was before.
And everybody I've ever sponsored, any person I've ever sponsored who starts pulling back to that drastic of a thing where they vanish – Right. I tell you, Dave, I've never seen the outcome be good. I've never seen it be good.
No, I mean, if someone's really working a program, they may disappear for a while, but they will come back.
Yeah.
And go, you know.
Right now, I've seen that happen.
Really know that I can really tell that I needed a meeting, and I wasn't sure how important these meetings really were until I wasn't here for a couple weeks. Or a month or...
I would never have heard about sponsorship or mentorship or spiritual advisors other than the fact that I went to a meeting and heard it. I would never have heard the steps unless I had been to that meeting. I certainly wouldn't have had the wonderful experience of drinking the worst coffee ever. Not going to that meeting. But I wouldn't have made...
Did you make it?
Yeah, sometimes. I wouldn't have made the host of friends that I made. I wouldn't have met people that had been where I'd been that could truly make me accountable and call me on my baloney if I hadn't been there. There was so much that I gained from that. And in the past, when I have pulled back for whatever reason, I miss it. I feel it and I miss it. And it help, and I'm glad I do because it helps me to get back on the rails again.
Right. Yeah, because if you never experienced any of that, you wouldn't know what you were missing. That's why a lot of people don't, they don't engage properly.
Right.
And so if they, they miss, they don't go to meetings, they don't work the steps, they don't get a sponsor, whatever part they're not doing. They don't know what they're missing because they've never experienced it.
Right, right.
I mean, most of my story anyway, but, I went to meetings every day for almost 2 years straight.
Mm-hmm.
Because I wanted to take the full, I wanted to find out everything that was out there.
Right.
I wanted to, part of that was, scared too. It's like, I don't know how to live a life without some kind of chemicals in my system. And... the only thing you have to change is everything. So I got to not isolate,
Right.
And so not isolating would be going to a meeting every day. So part of it was that out of being compliant.
Yeah.
To my commitment, but also it was I'm afraid to be up by myself because, left to my own devices, it's a pretty scary thing sometimes.
Ouch. And the other thing is, too, if we've been given this wonderful gift of sobriety and continued recovery and this new life, why wouldn't we want to help another person up from the ditch? And where are you going to find those folks? Many times, can you find them outside of the meeting? Sure you can, but I guarantee you, you will find them there. I remember my buddy Bruce used to be a co-host on our show here years ago, about a year and a half ago, he passed away, but he would say to me, he says, Monty, I'm going there to see where I can be a maximum service to God and the people he puts in my life.
Right.
And that's part of the maintenance of my spiritual condition. And as a result of that, I get to stay sober. And I don't miss out on this wonderful thing that I say is the most wonderful thing that's ever happened to me. Why wouldn't I want to share it?
Right. I share this with anybody who'll listen. We talk about the complacency. So people, they get all fired up, get in recovery, and they're going to meetings, and they get the sponsor, and they're doing all the stuff, right? Working the steps. And then life comes into play.
Yeah,
work.
And they get a job. Yeah,
work and promotions and kids and. And whatever, and then that's where sometimes complacency comes into there. And I always filter this through, if I'm doing something that's working for me, why would I stop?
Mm-hmm.
And it helps me to remember if things start going south, then I got to go back to doing what was working.
Right, right.
Because if it's working, why would you stop doing it? Why would you change things? It's like... To me, yeah. It doesn't make any sense.
Right. But we do it. I know guys that have been on a certain medication and their life changed. It was wonderful. They found that the sweet spot between their general practitioner and maybe their nurse practitioner, psychiatrist or whatever, and they found the medication that worked. And it worked for year after year. And then they said, I don't need it anymore. So they stopped taking it, and then their world came crumbling down. Now, why would you stop taking your medication that was working? It's the reason that you're doing well is because it's working. Why would you stop? And so we do kind of the same thing.
Well, we go back to leaning on our own understanding.
Right. And then
and we start listening to other people that we shouldn't be listening to.
Right.
Sometimes, and they give us bad information.
People that think they're doctors.
Well, yeah, I mean, sometimes, you know, I hate to say this, but sometimes Christians can be their own worst enemies.
It's you like, bet.
Well, no, God's going to heal me. I don't need to take this.
That's the spiritual bypassing again.
Again, we, granted, you know, there's good doctors and bad doctors,
sure,
and good medications and bad medications, whatever, supplements, whatever. You know, the thing is that God made opportunity for people to go to school to become doctors.
Right.
Right?
Right.
To help people.
Right.
Because there's this chemical imbalance. And, you know, we can go all kinds of down rabbit trails, but my belief is that God will help us get to where we need to be. And sometimes we have to go that route with the medication.
Yeah.
You know, and some people argue, well, if we just pray harder, if we just, you know, great, but not everybody falls into that. Not everybody can go that route because if their mental health is off,
right,
they can't process things properly. So sometimes the medication can help people put a Band-Aid on things to get to where they need to be,
yeah,
and eventually maybe get off the medication, or maybe not. Maybe they've done enough damage, and it may be physical damage or,
sure,
you know, things that we've done to ourselves, or, you know, accidents that we've been in, and head injuries, and all kinds of things come into play that, yeah, don't necessarily always filter things through. We always, it's like, well, you know, this is God's come and changed my life, so I don't need any of that. You know, I had a good example. I probably shared this with you before, but we had somebody in one of our programs one time that went to this ministry and was prayed over, and then all of a sudden they decided that they didn't, that you know, the demons were cast out and they don't need to take medication anymore. They had schizophrenia. And so pretty quickly, you know, after the medications got out of their system after a couple weeks,
yeah,
they resorted back to the same old behaviors because of the symptoms returned from schizophrenia. Started hallucinating, started hearing things, started threatening people's lives, and just, you know, and it's, and sometimes people don't know how, you know, I work with some people that were trained, but they're also Christians, and they're like, what do we do? I'm like, you take them down to the hospital and get them evaluated.
Right.
You don't sit there and pray over them, because right now the immediate thing is that their mental health, you know, they're endangering other people.
Yeah.
And they need to get, they need to get back on their medication, because they were functioning and they were doing well and they were progressing. And so that eventually that's what they ended up doing. But, you know, I couldn't imagine what it was like for this person to go through that period of time of that roller coaster. Mm-hmm. This, you know, people telling you, well, you know, you don't need to take that medication anymore.
Just pray harder.
Because, you know. And it's like, we can't, I mean, God could do miracles, trust me. I've done them in my life. But I took antidepressants for a period of time to get me over the hump when I first stopped drinking.
I had to do that,
drinking
too.
Drinking a gallon plus
right
every day.
You're yo-yo boy. I mean,
so, I'm like,
you need some
help. I need a little bit of, you know, and eventually, you know, after a few months, got off of them, but you know, it's like, hey, you know, my grandmother passed away as a result of cancer that could have been treated and possibly, you know, put in remission. She was in a car accident, and that's how they discovered it. Mm-hmm. And she refused treatment.
Mm-hmm.
She just believed that God was going to heal her.
Mm-hmm.
Well, later on, she, you know, after she passed on, I just had this, I felt like she was teaching me something from this experience. And it was like, you know, we make choices, right? Because I talk about this, you know, we have free will and we make choices. We have a choice on do what we're going to do or not. And it was kind of like that story about the guy you know, in the flood that's on the house, right? You've heard the story before.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, somebody comes by in a boat.
Yeah. Right?
Oh, no, God's going to save me. And then, you know, he dies and he's like, well, God, why didn't you save me? He's like, well, I sent you all this, you know.
All this stuff, yeah.
And you didn't want any help. So, and I think my grandmother went through the same circumstances. Like, God said, here's some help. And she refused. And those were the consequences, unfortunately, because I believe that she could have been healed or put in remission, or, you know, depending on, I don't know. That's what they say. They got caught it, you know, they caught it early enough. But it was a good lesson, you know. I was angry at first when it first happened, but and I realized God showed me some things. This was in my addiction too. I was able to see this. But it's one of those things that we can't push away anything.
No.
I mean, we have to be our own advocates, and we have to do the research, and we have to make sure that, you know, it's the right thing.
Especially today. We have to be our own advocates. Yeah.
Yeah, but we got to be careful, because we can't just say, well, okay, we see a commercial on TV and now I want that drug. It's like, no.
You got to do the investigation. You
should do the research and find out about it. What are the side effects? What are, you know, mm-hmm. because it's your life. The doctor's not going to, I mean, more often than not, the doctor's just going to, you're just assembly line. You know, every once in a while you get a good doctor, but you got to be your own advocate. I mean, I had to do that myself.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I could be complacent in that too and just say, well, okay, you know, I'll do what you tell me, even though I know it's wrong.
So sometimes a miracle doesn't show up as some sort of mystical weirdness. Sometimes it shows up with a PhD at the end of the name, or an MD at the end of the name.
Sometimes the miracle happens just showing up to a meeting and sharing your story.
Yeah. And that's another thing. If you've backed off from that, especially if you've been backed off for a long time, you may be missing some pretty powerful hours to hours and a half. Some pretty powerful stuff that you may either touch your life in a powerful way that you may not need that day, but you may be able to call on later, or something that you can impart to somebody else that really needs it. And you've heard it come from somewhere else.
I mean, don't know when it's going to happen. You know, I've had many times that, you know, I'm lucky enough to hear some of the results, but other times not. But sometimes in the middle, like there's one kid that I really always remember. It's kind of blew me away, and it kind of made the whole process of what I went through, the addiction, all the crap that I lived, and the recovery, made it all worth it. It's like, this is why I'm doing this. It's like, and it all started from a meeting, a gratitude meeting. Excuse me. A gratitude meeting we had on Thanksgiving. And there was probably, you know, we just did a big circle. There was probably, I want to say, 40 to 50 people there that night. And this one guy, I remember going around and he passed. He didn't want to talk. But after the meeting, he came up to me and I was standing with a couple of people and he said, you know, he said, what you guys shared really impacted my life. You know, to tell you the truth, I wasn't planning on coming to this meeting. I was planning on killing myself. You know, and for some reason, wow, I turned left and ended up at this meeting. And after hearing, you know, you guys talk, now I have some hope and I don't want to kill myself.
That's powerful stuff.
Right? And it just totally, I'm getting chills now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just totally blew me away. I'm like, it's the first time I ever like realized how powerful sharing what you're grateful for can actually do, what impact. And so I handed the guy, I remember handing the guy one of my business cards, and and then he went off and I didn't see him for a while. About 6 months later, I get a phone call and it's this guy. And he says, I don't know why I'm calling you, but I found your card in my wallet. And yeah. And so I said, you're calling me because you're supposed to.
That's great.
And he told me, you know, he was having relationship issues, and his girlfriend was kicking him out, and he didn't have any place to go, and he wanted to get some help, and he had a line on possibly on a place, and I gave him a line on this church that was nearby that the guys come to our meeting, and he says, I need to make a call, and I don't even have a phone or nothing. So I said, okay, I got one you can borrow. I'll be over in a few minutes. So I grabbed my daughter's phone, little flip phone, and I zipped over there. And when I pulled it up to the house, I looked at the phone and I realized there was only one bar left. The phone wasn't charged. No. And yeah. I was like, well, I said, you probably got enough juice to make one phone call.
Wow.
Or two. Yeah. You know? And so I said, just bring it to the meeting when you come. So the next day he called this place up and was able to get a bed, and then the phone died.
Wow. Wow.
And he showed up to the meeting and he gave me the phone back, which, you know, I didn't even think about it, whether or not he was going to give it back or not. I just thought, this is God, you know, I'm supposed to do this. This is all pieces of the puzzle that were supposed to be put together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then, I don't know, the guy was sober for a while and he disappeared again. I don't know what happened to him.
Yeah.
But
what if you had chosen not to go to that meeting that one day?
Well, I was in charge of it, so.
But people do that all the time. They don't show up with the key. Right, you know, right. I mean, it could have gone totally different, you know. And I think it's important for people to understand. And I don't want to put anybody on a guilt trip. But if you've been granted, with your cooperation with God, this gift of sobriety and this new life, and you've had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, et cetera, you really have a responsibility to carry the message in one way or another.
Right.
It's your responsibility. It's part of how your gratitude speaks. And if you're not doing that, how selfish is that?
You know, you mentioned something about what if you didn't go to that meeting. You know, it reminds me of this of another time that we had this small little meeting. There's usually only three or four of us show up.
Mm-hmm.
And I showed up because it was my turn to lead the group, and no one showed up.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, I mean, I made coffee and I waited around, and about 20 after, I went downstairs and I took the sign off the door. And as I was taking the sign off the door, some lady walks by and she says, "Is this where the meeting is?" And I said, "You're in luck. I was just about to leave, but, you know, come on in." Let's.
Right.
So we just, the two of us just, you know, we had a kind of impromptu,
yeah,
you know, informal meeting. And then we just sat there and talked. And she had talked about how she was struggling trying to find a place to go to treatment because she wanted to go to a faith-based treatment center.
Uh-huh.
And she looked all over the internet, and she looked all over, she found, you know, she mentioned Teen Challenge because she's like, oh, well, I'm not a teen. So, and I said, you know what? I says, I work there. It's not for teens. It's not just for teens.
Right.
There's
right.
more adults there than anything else, and the teens are separate. So I said, let me help you, you know, get in there for an assessment and right. then go from there. And
wow.
Like 2 weeks later, she was in treatment, and this was, I don't know, a couple years ago. She still goes to that meeting, and we still talk about that time she
That's
showed
great.
Up, you know, and it's.
She probably it's got more out of that meeting, just you and her,
right.
than maybe some meetings where there was 25, 30 people. Like, who knows, right? Some of those one-on-one things, or maybe three or four people only things, can be extremely powerful.
Well, it's totally a God thing, I believe.
Yeah.
You know, because if it would have been, you know, if I would have left at 10 after, right? 10 minutes, no one showed up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm out of here. But I'm like, no, I'm just going to read my book and have some coffee and, you know, see what happens. Because that's part of our deal as a trusted servant, is we're supposed to show up even if no one else is there, because that one day,
right,
when somebody will show up that needs to be there for that, you know, what happened. And
so we are almost out of time. Can I read this
yes,
just
sir.
For today?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
this comes out of the Just for Today book, December 16th. It is entitled Where There's Smoke. And it says, complacency is the enemy of members with substantial clean time. If we remain complacent for long, the recovery process ceases. That's from Basic Text, page 80. Recognizing complacency in our recovery is like seeing smoke in a room.
It's page 84.
It is?
Yep.
Mine says page 80. Hmm. Must be a different printing. I'm looking at it. Okay, 84 or 80. Recognizing complacency in recovery is like seeing smoke in a room. The smoke thickens when our meeting attendance drops, contact with newcomers decreases, our relations with our sponsor aren't maintained. With continued complacency, we won't be able to see through the smoke to find our way out. Only our immediate response will prevent an inferno. We must learn to recognize the smoke of complacency. In NA, we have all the help we need to do that. We need to spend time with other recovering addicts because they may detect our complacency before we do. Newcomers will remind us of how painful active addiction can be. Our sponsor will help us remain focused, and recovery literature, kept in easy reach, can be used to extinguish the small flare-ups that happen from time to time. Regular participation in our recovery will surely enable us to see that wisp of smoke long before it becomes a major inferno. Just for today, I will participate in the full range of my recovery. My commitment to NA is just as strong today as it was in the beginning of my recovery. And you can fill in AA, you can fill in CR, you can fill in whatever fellowship you're involved in. But this speaks to staying connected. And I like what it says. I will participate in the full range of my recovery. And so whatever that is for you, and everybody's a little different, right, Dave? I mean, we'll have these different basic tools in our toolbox. And then some of us have fancy ratchets. Some of us have bigger toolboxes. Some of us have smaller ones. But you have a toolbox. Use the tools. And because I know if
and
you don't.
Keep it simple.
And keep it simple. I know if you don't use something long enough, you forget how to use it.
That's a great analogy. That's why what I tell guys, I said, it's like playing sports.
Yeah.
Or an instrument, right?
Yeah.
You have to keep practicing.
You have to keep practicing. Yeah, you bet. And it can be. Feel like drudgery. I mean, my son, he's a music major, and he has to practice, and he has to learn a ton of different instruments because he's going to be a music professor at college level. So he is constantly, and he'll look at me and go, you know, but he gets back in there, and he keeps doing it to hone your craft. And for us, our craft's our recovery program if we're going to do this thing and actually give it away and be effective for other people that God puts in our life. So, good show, my brother.
As always.
Our closing song for this episode is by James Alker, and it is entitled A Call to Arms. You're going to enjoy this.
And beggars and bums and thieves, come gather round for your daily reprieve. All of us here are soaked in sin. Brothers and sisters, I call you my kin. Sang with the band as we shipped out to sea. We toasted the captain while sunk to our knees. We made it to shore by the skins of our necks. Now we share the scars we received from the wreck. Not all fight this proud fight until my dying breath. Your wretched, your poor and defeated, the bastard whose life is his father's repeated, the restless, the discontent and disheveled, the young heretics and the rousers of rebels. Now sing with me. Fight to the death. I'll fight this proud fight until my dying breath. So sing with me. We're all here. We're not all there. Gather your soldiers and fight to the death. I'll fight this proud fight until my dying breath. See, I'll fight this proud fight until my dying breath.
Mr. Jim Alker with his song, A Call to Arms. Well, until our next broadcast, this is the Monty Man along with Dave Fleming. And we're wishing God's perfect serenity for each and every one of you, reminding you all that because of God's grace, you are entitled to overcome.
This has been a broadcast of KHLT Recovery Broadcasting.